Sunday. Side by side at the microphone, from the green light to the speed trap, Chris Switzer and Ray Garino calls them as they sees them, and you better believe them. Here! Relevant news, biased opinions, and outright bullshit regarding every aspect of automotive culture. Gasp! With mechanical trickery never before revealed over FCC-regulated airwaves. Thrilled to the explosive tension as Chris and Ray cuss each other down the track and barrel roll across the finish line, laughing at certain disaster as they shake hands for the devil! All that and much more this Sunday at high noon on the Motormouth Radio Hour. Call in and speak live with the Wizards of Speed and live feed, Chris Switzer and Ray Garino. Bring the whole family. Kids under 12 get in free. Every Sunday at noon on WHPC. Take the Long Island Expressway to the Meadowbrook Parkway and look for the sign saying no parking on the expressway and no expressway. Parkway. Go right on Highway 24 to Garden City. $2 all-day parking includes pit pass. Sunday!
Run, a run, a do run, run, whoa, ho, run, a run, a do run, run, whoa, ho, run, a run, a do run, run, whoa, ho, run.
And you've tuned into two other car crazy cuties, Ray Guarino and Chris Switzer on Motormouth Radio, Long Island's only automotive talk show right here on the island of Long. And we're here to do damage, as always, to your psyche and your automotive whereabouts and knowledges. And right, Chris, tell us, tell them.
Car crazy what?
Cutie, car crazy cutie.
You've been my car crazy cutie for all these years, my longtime radio cutie colleague. How are you, Ray, on this fine, upstanding, slightly soggy Sunday here, at least in the Nutmeg State? I look out the window, and of course, it rained enough to just get everything wet. That's
Well, we got a pelting. You know, that I was. I was at a cruise event last night.
Tell me about your pelting, sir.
Yeah, I was at a cruise event, and it was good to see my buddies. I haven't seen in a while. Mikey Chevelle, his brother Bob, the Monte Carlo Steve, Jack. Jack was there. We went to the G-Body meet. This was the G-Body club.
And G-Body. We're talking mid-80s Monte Carlo, Cutlass, Pontiac Grand Prix vehicles.
Grand Nationals, all of those.
Grand Nationals.
So they met at a new place. We had been meeting at Burger City. Well, they had a meet at Burger City last time, but that's right here near the radio station, which is right in the middle of the giant T20 cricket match for the ages. So,
oh right, you guys have
didn't meet there. We met at the train station in Wantagh on Sunrise Highway at the Rolling Joint food truck. That's right. The Rolling Joint food truck.
And a happy 420 to you all.
So we met there, and I got to see all these guys, which was great. I hadn't seen them in a little while.
Were all high. They were all eating brownies.
Had some good food, man. Had some good dinner.
Pass that gummy bear, baby.
So they were all talking about what was going to go on this morning, who was going to which show. Mm-hmm. On the island, and they were all saying, well, look, I'll get up, I'll see what the weather's going to do. And everybody's on their phone checking their different weather apps. And they said, you know, basically, if it wasn't raining in the morning, there was only a 30% chance, maybe I'll go. Well, it wasn't bad this morning. It was a little gray.
Yeah.
So I went to the chiropractor at about 9 o'clock, and when I came out, it opened up.
Wearing his pants, I could say.
Yeah, we did. We got deluged. So it's still... I think we're past it. I see blue sky out the WHPC weather window.
Blue sky.
Yeah. So, listen, people, we haven't heard from callers in a while. They can call us at 516-572-7440. Ask us a question. Tell us a story.
Text us, too, here in the Nutmeg State Central. Yes, you can text us at 203-670-4127. And hopefully my phone will work.
Right, we had Lake Speed Jr. on last week, so we really didn't take any calls because Lake was such a good, he's such an arbiter of information. And I found myself last night kind of reiterating a lot of the things Lake said to us I told these guys about oil and oils, and you know, like if you guys got old oil, you know, I mean,
yep.
Can it?
I went into the garage and just looked at my wide array of old oil and went, I got to get rid of all this.
I know, I know. I know, very true.
There's some, I think I have some quarts of oil that my dad bought back like in the early 80s.
Mm-hmm.
That I'm sure, like Lake said, if you open that up and it's black, that's a problem. And I can bet dollars to donuts if I open up those quarts of oil, they will certainly be black. So I think I'll be making my trip over to the oil recycler very soon.
Oh, without a doubt.
With my crying towel, yep.
You know, and Brian, he had said that as he was listening to the show last week, he was kind of conglomerating all this Mobil 1 that he had. And then when he heard Lake say that if it was after 3 to 5 years, especially being an outside storage, which yep. he had in the show. So Brian's like, oh, great. I just got all the stuff together. Now I got to get rid of it. So, yeah, you know what? Check his channel out. He is the Motor Oil Geek on YouTube. Mm-hmm. And Lake has a ton. He's a tribologist, a real dyed-in-the-wool, honest-to-goodness tribologist. So he has all the right information, and he knows how to disseminate it. So check out Lake.
Yeah, and it's true. And he gives you – I mean, he was talking to us. There was some technology that he was passing around that even I went, what?
Yeah.
What is he saying?
Good stuff.
But, yeah. I'm just glad he knows and he can pass all that good information on to us because yeah. everybody has an opinion when it comes down to motor oil, myself included.
And a lot of it, and I found, you know, by watching the real guys that most of it is wrong, you know, what yeah. we believed over the years because it's just, you know, became common lore.
And yet the people still listen to us and we still do a radio show every week.
Believe it or not.
Don't
so
figure.
The other thing I want to do is I want to throw a big thanks out to my buddy Ricky. Ricky, you know, we've been friends a long time and he does, has always done glass work. Mm. So when I was at his house a few weeks ago, I had my Pontiac and one of the things I did not change in that car was the rearview mirror because
okay.
it was what I thought was the original mirror to the car. And I said, I'm going to leave it. But then I noticed like,
oh,
you know, the back of the mirror, it was made like an old house mirror where the back, you have that like the leaded surface that you kind of get like that wavy line in the mirror.
Oh, yes.
Start to degrade.
So in the glass itself.
Yes.
Behind the glass, I should
Correct.
Say.
Correct.
Because a mirror is many different layers of glass and silver, and there's many different layers. I can't give you all of them, but they all start to break down, I'm assuming.
And they do it even cheaper now. It's like glass and foil. So anyway, Rick had made me a I put a right side mirror on my car that I bought.
Finally.
I've had it for a while, but I bought it aftermarket. And I noticed, though, it wasn't a concave mirror to give you a wide angle. You know, it was just a flat, regular mirror. And I said, well, that's crazy. I can't really see. Now, any other modern car has a concave mirror on that side. So,
Or a little note that says images may appear closer than they seem on the bottom of the mirror.
Which is why, because it's concave. So I asked Rick if he could make me a concave mirror. And he had to go through a bunch of stuff, but he did it. He did that for me a few years ago, and it was great. So now I asked him, I said, hey, Rick, can you make me a new mirror for my rear view? You know, I said, I could buy a mirror for like 30 bucks. It's not the price. It's just, I want to keep the mirror original. So he took it. And as he was playing around with it, because the only thing I'm afraid of is the gasket might, instead of really stretching at my crack, I said, whatever happens, happens. If it turns to trash, I'll buy a new one. You know, it's not like I'm married to this thing. It's just, I like to keep it if I can.
Right.
He got the glass out and found out it was actually cut like a wedge.
Okay.
That's because as a day night feature. And that's sure. how that, so the wedge actually changes you're looking at a different thickness of the glass to change what the mirror looks at.
So you're not going to have that day night feature if you replace the glass, right?
I'll find out. I don't know. Maybe not. Well, I found out something else because now that he had the mirror, he had it for a while. Kevin and I were at a cruise night last week in Kevin's car. I had looked in my Ames catalog quick just to see what a mirror would cost. And again, they showed the 64 to 65 mirror. Non-day night was like $24.
Okay.
But they had a day night, and it had a black lever under the bottom, and that was like $30-something.
All
so,
right.
Again, not a lot of money. Then I saw the next mirror in line was the 67-68 mirror, which had this gray lever, which is the one I have in my car. So I was like...
I see where this is going.
And I'm thinking, I have the wrong mirror in my car. But where did it come from? And the only other thing, I owned a 68 years ago that I bought as a parts car. That's where my motor is out of, you know. And I took some other stuff. I'm like, did I take the day-night mirror out of that car to put in my car because I didn't have it? I don't remember.
You owned that car for so long. And mind you, next year, if I'm correct in my math, you're going to own that car for 50 years.
That's right.
Are you out of your mind?
No.
Anyway. Are you completely off your taco shell, young man?
Yeah.
50 years. You own a car for 50 years. You should be chastised within an inch of your life with the wet noodle.
Right.
Who owns a car for 50 years? You.
Well, anyway, Rick was.
And you don't remember what you did to it.
That's because it was so long ago. So Rick was able to make the mirror. He dropped her off at the shop to me on Saturday. And thanks again, Rick. That was great. Now at least I can keep my old. Well, you know what it is? I have my old parking pass from one of the jobs I had in the 80s on the back of the mirror. And again, that's a little piece of nostalgia too, because it was, you know, part of.
You don't remember the job you had, but you have the parking pass.
Yeah,
for it.
Right. Exactly.
That's so great. No, that's not. I'm goofy. I'm joshing you. I'm goofing. It's a noble thing to own a car for 50 years, to have a car that has not bored you. Because that's usually what happens to me. I get bored with it. I'm like, all right, I fixed everything. Let it go.
Well, if you're bored and I'm not joshing, you can give us a call, 516-572-7440. Mm-hmm. And check us out on social media, Motormouth Radio on X and Facebook, and it's Real_Motormouth Radio on Instagram.
And, so,
yeah.
Can I tell you, I had an experience this week, Ray, I have not experienced since high school.
Oh, wow. What was the name? Okay. All right.
My wife's listening.
All right. Forget
no,
that.
She turned out a long time ago.
Oh, good.
We can talk about it. No, I was on the road with the tracker, and I'm driving along, just bopping along, listening to my tunes, going to just drop off junk, and I'm on the merit, having a ball, sun is shining, and all of a sudden I hear, boom. Uh-oh. And then the turned into boom.
Uh-oh.
I popped the exhaust pipe.
Did you? Wow.
I haven't done that since like 1983 in a 64 Cadillac.
I didn't think that car had enough compression or oomph to pop an exhaust pipe.
Well, when it spends most of its time on the highway with my foot on the carpet with the gas pedal.
Yeah, I guess so.
In a good tailwind, because that's the only way you can make it to 56 miles an hour. No, it actually runs better than that. I've actually got it up to 70 in certain areas, but
wow,
not for very long. But yeah, so I brought it back to the house, and I noticed that it has on both where the exhaust manifold comes down under the car and then meets with the exhaust pipe, it flares there. They both have these flares, and the bolts, both of those bolts that tie those together, have given way.
Ah.
So, of course, everything is so rusted. The flares, the flanges are still in good shape, which is nice. All I have to do is replace the bolt and the nut. But the nut has been welded to the flange on the exhaust manifold going up. So I have to grind that flat and then punch a hole in it with a drill and get that hole big enough that I can send two nut bolts, a long bolt with a couple of washers, and attach it all together again, because I am not going to spend money on this thing. I have buckets of hardware, and I save that hardware for stupid jobs like this.
You do yourself a favor and just drive to an exhaust shop. It'll be in the long run, it'll be cheap.
You're right. You're right. You're absolutely right. But you always know. And this is something I've learned about Japanese vehicles. They don't repair the exhaust. They replace the exhaust, and they don't replace the exhaust unless it's the entire exhaust.
I think what you have to do, the difference there, the caveat is you have to find a shop that's willing to do. a repair as opposed, because sure, they want to replace the whole thing. That's the easiest thing to do.
Right. You forget where I live.
Well, I don't live there, so I don't really understand
right.
that.
I'm nowhere near like anywhere like Hunts Point or what's you know, where they can do everything, you know, yeah. by where Shea Stadium used to be.
That's what all that gone, area? Man. They took over all of that. That's all done. Yeah.
What was that? Hollis? Trying to think of the areas.
You go down there, hang out with the Beastie Boys.
Yeah, and if I was back in Brooklyn, believe me, that's where I'd be going. But unfortunately, up here in the area of Connecticut.
Well, I tell you what, we're going
like that does not exist.
We're going to the phones to say, hi, caller, you're on with the Exhaust Mouths, Ray and Chris.
The Exhaust Mouths? I thought that was last Sunday.
That was the Oil Mouths.
That was a great show, by the way. Oh, my. You could have him on for probably 3 hours if you opened up the phones for calls. Oh,
you know, yeah. Right. Lake is a phenomenal guest, and he is so informative. Yeah. Glad you liked him, John.
Yeah, he was good.
You turned me on to his YouTube channel, and I've been watching and picking away at I got to binge watch it on one snowy day in the winter.
Nah.
But he's got a wealth of information out there.
Yeah,
awesome
true.
Show.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, John.
I was so curious to get on there because I just did an oil change on the vet. And the best bang for the buck, I went to Walmart and bought Box Mobile One oil.
Oh, yeah. I've been doing it. You know, we were talking about this last night at the Roland Joint Food Truck, how Walmart, and all these guys agreed, is the best. That's everybody's go-to for buying oil. They do. And I got that VR1 Castrol, the high zinc oil there. 5 quarts for only $29. I'm paying like almost $15 a quart online for this stuff.
And you could definitely tell, because every time you go there, the shelves are empty.
Right.
They clear them out.
At the time, one guy asked me, what Walmart are you going to? And I said, I go up to East Meadow up here. Oh, yeah, because I go to, in Farmingdale on 110. They're always empty. I said, yeah, the one in Uniondale is always empty, too. So I said, you got to pick and choose.
Yeah, they cleared the shelves.
And the amazing part was you get 12 quarts in the box. And I think it was about $12 more than buying 5 quarts in a jug.
Exactly. Yes.
Wow. It was like, that's almost 2 oil changes.
Right.
But again, the shelf life of the oil was certainly a topic of discussion last Sunday.
So don't store it in the garage or shed and keep it for after three to five years.
Yeah, I gotcha. But, I'm figuring they're going to be 12-month-apart oil changes. It doesn't go that many miles.
No, I know. Yeah, I understand. Well, you'll be fine.
I wanted to get on, and my tongue-in-cheek to Lake would have been, does boxed oil last like boxed wine?
It all depends on what keg you keep it in.
Right.
Yep. Certainly not a convertible morning.
No.
No.
It may be more conducive this afternoon.
I think the afternoon is going to be nice. Yeah, we've had some really nice convertible days. But I've been out rocking the Fiat every day, and I'm loving it.
I've had the vet out every day. Yeah. But yesterday was spectacular.
Yeah, it was. In fact, I took the Fiat to the cruise night last night, and I rolled in, and these guys, they know me from, having the Pontiac, and they're like, they did a double take when I got out of the car. What the heck is that?
I gotcha. Yeah, I went to a show Wednesday night with the vet, and my buddy took his Porsche, and oh my God, there was just spectacular looking cars.
Where did you go, John? What cruise night?
It's over at Eastwind's Catering.
Okay.
On Wednesday nights, right out in the parking lot. And,
all right.
Nice venue if you want to take a little bit of a journey. I know for you it's a haul.
Well, no, that's why I've been going out to see my buddies out in Whitestone. Let me get on the highway and do actually a little real cruising,
Yeah, well.
John, I was...
an appetite for it. It'd be great to get together and vice versa.
Yeah.
I was at a cruise night, when was it, last week in Seymour, Connecticut, with my cousin Pat's 427 Corvette, the 67 427 he has. He and I drove out there. Boy, it's so funny. When you have a car that's in a different value bracket, it's like a whole different show. Like, yeah. I always see my cars are always like, have always been like these curiosities. There's not, people come over and they critique, they look, I remember I had one, my mom had one when I was a kid, blah, blah, blah. You get those stories. But when you come in with something rocking like that and it's all stock,
yeah,
and you get the guys, you get the haters, which is kind of funny.
Those are the best.
Yeah, because they come up. There was one guy that actually started to knock the car he brought.
Oh, wow.
He was like, yeah, he had a 63 split window, small block automatic. And the first thing he said to us, he goes, yeah, there's my split window. It's my wife's car. It's a small block. It's an automatic. And he's like, I want to give him the crying towel. I mean, the poor guy was... I was like, this is something I will never see with a vehicle I personally own.
No.
Yeah, I got you, Chris. And the funniest, like you were saying, right, he owned his car 50 years.
There, oh, yeah.
Guy with an old Box Nova. And I'm going to say mid-60s if I'm in the hood. Original owner.
Wow.
And the car looked like it just rolled out of the showroom.
Wow.
I mean, it was spectacular, and I was drooling all over it. I started talking with him. You know, he goes, yeah, I bought it, you know, after I got, I think he bought it new, but he says, I was a Vietnam vet, and nice old guy, and we started talking. He goes, I had it restored, I think he said 20 years ago. And I mean, if you looked at the paint on it, wherever he's keeping it is got to be one of the most pristine storage units.
Yeah. Nice. Nice.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Cool.
What a spectacular, you know, ride.
Cool. To own a car. All right, John, we'll keep hitting those cruise nights, and I'll let you know if I'm coming out your way one of these days.
Yeah.
Right, and keep an eye out on the road, John. It sounds like you're in the middle of the highway again.
Raceway, I know.
I live on a busy road, and I'm in the garage.
You used to live across from a sod farm when it was nothing but cows and sod.
No, the sod farm across the street turned into a whole development.
I know.
Wow.
In the backyard, the sod farm's still behind my house.
Yeah, crazy. All right, Johnny, we'll keep in touch.
At least it's not a cow pasture, so it's
Yes, very true.
Don't stand downwind, yeah.
All right,
John.
Let's hope for a topless afternoon.
You got it.
You got it.
All right, John.
There's something flimsy, John.
Right. You know, I want to mention before we get into the bottom of the hour break that there's a car show coming up, Chris, that I know you know and love very well. It's this is the Police Surgeons Benevolent Association and the Centurion Cruisers Car Club.
Ah,
car show. It is.
Yes.
It's going to be Sunday, June 30th, and it is at where else on 275 Wolf Hill Road in South Huntington, but St. St. Anthony's,
of course, St. Anthony's.
You're slipping on me. I thought you'd remember it. Yeah, so that's coming up. Lots of classes.
That's where we heard "Hello, boys." An awful
lot. John Flynn's exactly.
John Flynn's.
Check that one. So I want to tell you something that happened to me Saturday. I did.
What?
2 weeks ago, when I had the Fiat at the shop, I put it up on a lift, and I welded it. I told you, I welded up that front shock.
You did, yeah. Right?
So far, so good. The car feels great. Well, now I noticed the other day, I'm sitting there, I'm looking at the car, and I said, the car looks like it's sitting a little lower in the back than it used to.
Oh.
Now, go back 20, I don't know, 15 years, that car sat higher in the back than in the front.
It did. And it always had a little rake going on.
And what I did was when I cleaned out, when I sold my mom's house, I had three ham units, rear end ham units from a 55 Chevy in the trunk with some other junk. And when I looked at the car then, it sat level.
That's right.
That's what I got to do. I mean, this is going a long time ago. What I did is I took out the rear coil springs and I cut a coil and a half off. And it leveled the car. Beautiful. And it's been like that since. So now I'm saying, why would it drop? I have nothing of weight in the trunk. Mm-hmm. Like, what the heck? So it just so happened I was doing some work at my workbench in the basement, and my knees always hit what's under the bench. And I'm like, damn, what is that? And I took out, I bought these four shock absorbers, KYBs, off of eBay, I don't know, 10 years ago for the Fiat.
Right.
And I said, you know, Maybe it's the rear shocks. Maybe the rear shocks that are in there were used. They were used, not KYBs, the other high-tech brand. Oh, geez, I can't think of the name.
Well, the shock isn't going to dictate the height of a vehicle.
Well, it can. It can because, well, what I did is I changed the shocks yesterday.
You did.
And what a design. The shock goes through the spring. So, and the
very Ford-like.
The lower bushing is on a, goes into like a little, a caged affair on top of the rear end where the spring is. So once you undo that bolt, you have to lower the rear. You have to bring the rear down so you can let the spring up to get the shock out.
Oh, wow.
And at first doing that was like, my God, like this is such a pain in the neck. I was like, wow, this is weird. And I'm thinking, last time I did this was when I cut those springs, and I did this on my driveway with a floor jack. Now here I am on a lift, and I'm thinking, how am I going to do this? Well, got it done. Did both sides, lowered the car, and you know what? The car's level again.
Really?
It's level again. So the shocks did it. The fresher set of used KYBs. Ah, the Bilsteins were what was in there.
Okay.
Yeah. So, wow. Yeah. Yeah.
I wouldn't think that would dictate the spring would dictate the ride height of the most times. I don't think the shock would have anything to do with it.
But you know, I guess with a gas charged shock in a smaller car, it can. And one of the shocks, the left shock was actually when I looked at the car, I was looking at the right side, but the left shock was blown. That shock was bad.
So, you had oil running down the side of it and everything.
It's sure. Greasy, yeah. Yeah,
yeah, it's usually how I can tell. You look up, if the shock is dry, it stays.
Right.
It's got to look a little oily.
And that's the thing, from the ground, you really can't see on the ground because the car is low, it's small, sure. And mm-hmm. The shock goes through the spring, so you're obscured by that too.
Right.
So,
Yeah, I was thinking of like a Ford front suspension when I said like very Ford-like because that's how it's set up there, but the shocks,
my Pontiac shocks go through the
they do
front. Yeah, all the Chevys, all the GMs do, from that era. But yeah, this is so luckily I had the spare shocks. Didn't cost me a dime. It was money I spent 15 years ago or so, and put another pair of used shocks in there. You know,
and something you won't have to move.
Right.
Yeah. Isn't that good?
Yes, exactly.
Some crap you will not have to take out of your house.
Well, I tell you, I don't have to take out of my house this, but I would like to bring it in. Mm. And it is some PDQ chicken. If you want, the WHPC app wants to give you some PDQ chicken.
Nice segue, Bryce. Very good.
Thank you. You download the app and click the Win Stuff button to enter to win a PDQ Beach prize pack.
Wow.
I guess you get a chicken bikini, a chicken sunglasses, maybe some chicken sunspray. I don't know.
Yes. So, chicken headdress. Yeah.
That'd be cool. So they also include a $25 gift card to PDQ, which means people dedicated to quality. And I tell you, that chicken is damn good. I've had it. It is phenomenal. They have locations in Westbury and Farmingdale. So download the free WHPC app and good luck with your PDQ.
Did you think of that yourself?
Yeah, it was. They didn't write that on a form, though.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
So, listen, WHPC weather update.
Yes.
This forecast, powered by Does Bagels, with locations in Garden City Park. See, it's not on one line, so you have to. That's weird. Freeport, Levittown, and now open on 7th Street in Garden City. Today's forecast. Rain showers this morning. It is clear. I'm looking out the WHPC weather window, and I do see cloudy skies, but bright. So I think the rain has passed. They were calling for clear skies this afternoon with a high of 78. I know our friends in the Southwest, Isaac, was still out there in the hundreds the other day, and we were like, thank God we're up here.
Yeah. Well, I you know me, I kind of flourish in that weather, but I'm sure even that would get a little too warm for me.
Tonight, partly cloudy, low of 61. Tomorrow, sunshine and clouds mixed with 77. So, yes, you can drive toplessly, as John and I have been doing. And while we drive toplessly, do we have a honor group of the hour to think about?
Wow, very funny you should say that, talking about segues. Because this week, the group we love to honor here at the Motor Mouth Radio Honor Group of the Hour is if you own cars that have T-tops.
Oh.
And we didn't call a confer on this, gang. This is
no.
If you, this is like-minded thinking here. If you suffered through the rust in the roof, the frequent clogged drains, and the rotted floors behind the front seat, all due to the top weather stripping, the T-top weather stripping shrinking considerably, mm-hmm. is taking off the top a huge ordeal since your car is older than a 2002 Camaro or Firebird, the last cars to offer T-tops, dealing with the sticking clasps and peeling rubber seals. Just say the heck with it. Just leave them attached as you drive. Are you tired of explaining why you keep tubes of black silicone, WD-40, Armor All, and jars of Vaseline in the trunk of your car, which gets in the way of storing the tops? And you are perfectly fine with getting leaked on in any sort of weather, slightly more humid than a drizzle. So if the squeaks, creaks, and rattles of a 20-plus-year-old T-top vehicle are music to your ears, then you are part of the Motor Mouth Radio Honor Group of the Hour this week. There you go.
Excellent. Excellent. So with that, I don't have anything with T-tops. So with
neither with do I.
We'll take care of a little bit of business here. And we'll be back with more Motor Mouth Radio on 90.3 FM with your host, Ray Guarino and Chris Switzer.
And I'm going to reminisce a little more when we come back. So I got a little bit of reminiscing to talk about.
So keep it where you got it. And you know what? Go out for a quick drive and come back because you don't want to miss the rest of the show on 90.3 WHPC.
We'll be back with answers to your car questions. Give us a call at 516-572-7440. Oh, I should have said the Motor Mouth thing.
This show on 90.3 WHPC is brought to you by CarStar Celebrity Chase Collision, with two locations in Limerick and Oceanside, who remind you that New York State law says you always have the right to choose which shop will fix your car. CarStar Celebrity Chase Collision offers a full range of services, 24-hour towing between Montauk and Manhattan, shuttle service, and they can help you with a rental car arrangement if needed. All repairs include the CarStar Lifetime Nationwide Warranty, ensuring that the experts at Celebrity Chase Collision are always on your side.
Y si hablamos español.
More information is available at 516-593-0920 or online at celebritychasecollision.com.
You're listening to the Motor Mouth.
What are we talking about? This is a car show.
Finally, I got through after 2.5 weeks.
Thanks a lot, guys. You're the best, man.
Motor Mouth.
Is this the radio program where automotive enthusiasts can be spoken down to?
Are we on the air now?
I turned on PMN, and I heard you guys on there.
Motor Mouth.
You guys are really getting around, man. I don't know.
Yeah, it's great. You guys handle it pretty well, too.
I just was listening through the computer.
On the download, the motormouthradio.com website.
I did get to see the GTO.
Motor Mouth.
You know, I didn't know if it really existed or not, if it was a figment of Ray's imagination.
No problem. Great show, guys. I've been listening to you guys for many years. Love your show, and this is about the fifth time I've actually got the nerve up to call.
Our trained staff of two will help.
Well, you guys are the tech experts, not me.
Is it the jerk who, like all the other jerks who listen to this show?
You guys are so easy to play along.
Quite frankly, there are better things to do with your time.
This was wonderful. I think it's the second time I've ever been on a radio, and I'm liking it.
Yeah, I want to know what the is wrong with my car.
You guys are hilarious.
Yeah, I feel like I need to talk to an attorney and a policeman when I talk to you guys.
Motor Mouth!
I listen to Car Talk as well.
Glad to be here. Sounds like a lot of fun.
You know, like after calling you guys, I'm probably going to blow out another brake line or two in the next week.
There are answers, sometimes correct ones, and we may have them.
Motor Mouth Radio, 90.3 FM, WHPC.
Motor Mouth!
Hey, you, get over here. Every Sunday, 12 to 1, you are going to tune in to hear the Motor Mouths, my friends Ray Guarino and Chris Switzer, 90.3 FM, WHPC. You might learn something.
Vince wanted to know that, too. Yeah, I'm going to drive myself home. Everything's good. So, all right, we're back. Motor Mouth Radio, Long Island's only automotive-based show with your hosts Ray Guarino, Chris Switzer, 516-572-7440 is how you can get a hold of us right now live. But Chris, you wanted to say something, didn't you?
Yes, I did. I was going through the basement recently and I found a box, and I opened up the box, something I have not found in a long time. I was going through, rummaging through, and there was a box within another box, and in there was a pair of shoes that I have not seen in probably 30 years, a pair of sneakers. And I was like, holy smokes. I mean, obviously there was shouldn't have been stored as long because they're no longer wearable. They're almost dry rotted and falling apart. But I did notice something on them. It did have a cut at the top of the sneaker by the laces. And I was like, how did that happen? I can't, usually you don't damage a shoe at the top of the shoe. And I'm like, how did that happen? And then I remembered I had a Dodge St. Regis that needed a power booster for the brakes, because every time you stepped on the brake would go down to the floor. You'd stop the car, but the pedal wouldn't come back up.
Oh, wow.
And I drove the car that many, it must have been weeks. I drove that car, but by reaching my foot under the pedal and pulling the pedal back up again.
Sounds very safe.
And that's what I was thinking. Here's the funny thing. This is where your mind goes into like warp mode, because I'm saying when I was in my 20s, I guess you could say, what did I have? I had nothing. I had two cars. I had a part-time job and I was going to school. Now, at the ages we are, we have so much more to lose.
Well, that's true.
If you wreck a vehicle, I'm like, I wouldn't be caught dead driving that car to the mailbox right now, which is 100 feet from my garage door. And I'm like thinking to myself, I wouldn't even want to move this car anywhere in the condition that it was in at the time. Because now you think to yourself, there's so much more to lose. It's like when you talk about you are a gentleman and you work on your car on a lift, I'm still jacking the thing up with the hydraulic jacks, you know, floor jacks and jack stands. You have to see the jack stands I put under the car now.
You know,
it's like I need like a box girder bridge to slide under the car to keep it from falling. That's how paranoid.
You would have chuckled if you saw what I did yesterday. At one point, putting these shocks in, I put the left one in first. Right. And then, you know, and I had a screw jack under the rear end, you know, to support it. Sure. And I had to let that down because then I had to actually pull the rear tire down to lever the axle at an angle so I could get that spring off the perch. I mean, everything else was still in place, so it wasn't going anywhere. But then to do the reverse, to put the shock up.
Now you got to fight that spring.
I had it on. And luckily, they were already cut a coil and a half, remember?
Right.
But still, I put the shock up, found the top of it, went through the hole, which is now in the trunk of the car.
Right, so getting up.
I secured the bottom of it with the bolt.
Right.
And then I started lowering the car. And I got it down to a working height, but which was only like the tire was literally 2 inches like off the ground. That was a good working height for me. But then when I reached in, I couldn't feel the top of the shock through the hole.
Right.
Because the rear end was hanging on that side. So what did I do? I said, all right, I got the floor jack. But now the rear end was still, it was about, you know, a couple feet up. So I took a piece of 2x4, stood it on the floor jack under the rear end. And as I cranked the floor jack, the axle came up and the shock came through the hole. Reached in, the nuts on, lowered the jack, pulled it out. Those are the things. Now, I didn't have to do that on the other side. I was able to do it without that on the other side. So I don't know.
I do remember taking a set of shocks out of a 74 Caddy when I was a young man. And I never realized when I had the car in the air, I didn't realize that the shocks were attached to the rear. Yeah. And I've come to realize you could run when you're under the car, you could run on your butt cheeks.
Right.
I've come to realize
we're gonna run over here. We're
scampered out from under that car and I didn't use my feet.
We're gonna run to the phone and say, hi, caller, you're on with the Motor Mouths.
We're talking about how not to lift up vehicles with jack stands and 2x4s. And
oh, we're talking about how to get the job done, Glenn. You know that.
I've been there, done that. I'm on Chris's page with this.
Right.
I wish I had a lift.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Glenn, I admire Ray. I'm jealous, envious.
Well, I wish I had a lift.
Well, you know, it's easy.
You fight this stuff all the time.
Always. Yeah, and even with the lift, you know, with the lift, I always say what the lift gives you, the one thing it gives you that you can't get otherwise unless you have a pit is leverage. Because laying under the car, if you have a breaker bar or ratchet, you can only move so far and you're always at a weird angle because you're.
Well, when you're under the car, you can't get leverage.
Right. When you're standing under the car, you could use a 4-foot bar and you can lean on the deck. So that's what it gives you. It gives you the ability to have leverage. True. Yeah.
Right. And, you know, going through the shocks, like what you're talking about, I have to check what I did. Yeah, I did all my suspension, and it's not I wish it were better. Like, in other words, I was expecting – I have noises, number one, that I kind of got to target and figure out where they're coming from. And right. I think that maybe the rear shocks aren't the proper length.
Really? Okay.
Now, I went through – I guess there's a way you measure the height at where it's drooped. In other words, like full travel, and I'm wondering
– Right, right.
Not 100% correct. I said, well, the car goes down the block. It drives. Obviously, I've been driving it.
And Glenn, this is on your 69 Camaro, correct?
Yeah, yeah. You got to kind of go back and always rethink what you did or revisit what you did.
Right, right.
And then you need time to do so. And then you got to do your crafty, I guess, driveway.
Yeah, gymnastics. I got to tell you, you know, now just as a side story, this Mustang, which I think I named it the Mudstang, Mike had said to me, now the owner didn't do this because he bought the car this way. He says, hey, you know, did you look at the rear of that car? I'm like, well, yeah, I did look quick. I did an assessment. He goes, are the rear shocks supposed to be in upside down? And I went and looked. I'm like, well, they are certainly in upside down, and no, they should not be. I said, wow. Now those the rear shocks have the metal covers that the now they're umbrellas catching whatever is going to fall into them.
Anything's going to fall in there.
You know what? Yeah,
we're going to have to change.
Probably would work, but
they will work. They will work, but we're going to have to change that. Obviously, we're going to.
What year is that Mustang?
66.
Oh, so it's an older. Like, I had the Fox bodies, and I called my one was the Rustang.
Yeah, yeah,
A little bit of rot and tin worm, and anyway.
Right.
And I saw that those photos. I tried to watch the other night on Thursday, playing in traffic. And next thing you know, if I do, and I'm sitting back and I'm tired after a long day, well, I start watching the back of my.
Glenn, let me tell you something right now.
I'm not saying anything here.
Let me tell you what happened Thursday night. I ended the Lewis left a couple people. I ended the live stream about an hour and a half in, and myself, Brian, and Isaac stayed on. It got to be about 11:25, 11:30, and I felt myself closing my eyes. But I was listening. I was like, all right, open the eye. I did that about three times, and then the last time I heard them both saying, Ray! And I was like, huh? I was out.
Snoring in between.
I was the sitting, walking dead man. I was. Yeah. I said, well, at least we're not live. I said, all right, guys, guess what? We're done.
Glenn, I actually had my phone. I couldn't sleep one night, and I took my phone, and I was listening to the show.
That does it, yeah.
I was out cold.
And that's a good way to kind of like take your mind off of trying to sleep, and then you will fall asleep.
Right.
I feel so bad, but I'm so glad I've been with good company.
I guess we should name everything the Dr. Sleep Podcast. I don't know if it works. I mean, a lot of people, you know, I know we have Justin on, and I, you know, I feel bad because Justin sometimes nods late in the show, but the guy works, he works at American Gas, a hot rod shop. The guy works all day. It's late. I get it. I understand, you know.
I did the same work all day. Whenever you come home, I'm kind of tired. I try to knock some things off on my to-do list. I wish I could do more.
Yeah.
Never the case. Always looking for time.
Well, Glenn, I'll tell you, this is why I've become, and I am, the big proponent for the afternoon nap. I will take. I said, I got to get a couple hours in the afternoon so I could stay up later at night. And, you do
a little bit here and there, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. Now the weather's better. I hope to do some more car stuff. It's
got to get you out to one of these cruise nights, Glenn. We hang out with some really cool guys, cool cars, and
I wanted to go just over to Belmore, and I said, "Oh, I'll go. I'm definitely going to go."
Belmore is a real nut show these days. I'll tell you that.
Well, it seems that like what's earlier. In other words, it's not what I thought later. It seems like some of the nicer cars are there earlier.
Yes. Well, I'll tell you what we've been going out to Massapequa on Monday night. It's a food place. It's closed. It's right by the mall out there. If you're interested on Monday, hit me up and you can cruise out there with Kevin and I. We're going to be going if the weather is nice. So if you want to go,
well, I don't know if I have anything on my
let me know
family calendar, the to do list, but yeah. Right.
Well, yeah, if let me know, and then you can come. You'll meet at my house, and we'll cruise out.
All right. If that's the case, I'll let you know. Otherwise, right. I'm gonna carry on with troubleshooting a gas gauge on the boat. I've got some issues.
All right.
No,
very good.
Got no gauge working at the moment. So
okay.
I'll be in touch.
Check the ground.
All right. Be well.
All right, Glenn. Thanks. So long.
Talk to you, Glenn. Bye-bye.
Yes. Glenn, I love the way that Camaro has come together over the years. I remember when he built it from a six-cylinder. He was working for me at the college here, and he was a student. And it really came together as a really nice street machine. It is. It's a great car.
And he works on it on a budget too, which is even better.
Don't we all?
Yeah.
And I want to say, like, it hit me last week looking at this Mustang in the shop. The owner was there because he was doing some filming, and he was asking me questions about what I really thought about the car and what, you know, my impressions and whatnot. And I had to let him down kind of gently because I know how much he likes this car, and I'm thinking, from where it is now to being a finished, substantial vehicle, it's a long road.
It's a long time.
I've been on that road, and I know it is a long road.
Sure is.
It started making me think about, just in general, a project like that, how the planning needs to be done. And I've done this. Even when you plan in one direction, sometimes doing other things makes that other thing change. You know, it could be because of parts, maybe because of availability, maybe because something new came out,
sure. Maybe
because you changed your mind. But you have to be able to have a fluid, I think you have to have a plan, but you have to be able to fluidly modify it as you go.
Alter it, yes. Yeah, you can't, unless, you know me, I'm going stock all the time.
Then the plan has been laid out for you.
Right. And
parts.
But then it all depends on parts acquisition. That's really what it turns out to.
Yes.
Do you go salvage? Do you go new NOS? Do you go reman? And a lot of times, even when you go stock, like you say, there could be a certain fluidity to the plan because, okay, let's say you have a one chamber master cylinder and you really would like a dual chamber master cylinder. Something like that's not going to affect the value of a vehicle.
No.
In most cases, it actually will sustain the value of a vehicle. So if you make the car roadworthy, more roadworthy than it already was, that's where I would deviate from stock. But still, now you're talking about research, you're talking about some sort of authenticity. Like if you have a 65 GTO and that has a one lung master cylinder, and you have to get one from a 66 GTO because that's a two lunger to put on there, maybe you want to go for the all Pontiac parts, you know, that sort of those. There's also that research goes into those decisions as well.
Yeah.
So
it's interesting because Kevin just did that with his 68 GTO. He has four-wheel drum dual master, but four-wheel drum, and he wants to go to disc. So, you know, we shared a lot of information. I shared a lot with him and said the aftermarket is certainly have these cars covered.
Oh, Willwood, yes.
There. Just not even
alone.
I mean,
one phone call.
I give you like five brake companies off the top of my head that
make
stuff for those cars. So he looked at it, and what he decided to do is he sourced out original parts. He found a set of spindles. He found a set of rotors, the calipers. So he wanted to have like an original style
smart
on the car, which certainly will work just as well as anything else. So you know, that was his choice to go that way, and it was available to him, which is great. And the thing is, it may be, it could certainly be easier if you're on a road trip one day, and I mean, if a caliper happens to go bad and you need a GM single piston caliper from those years, they call it a D52. You can get one of those at most 7-Elevens, but whereas
most Walmart.
As popular as the Willwood is, I don't really know of anybody really stocking Willwood calipers. So
yeah, probably you'd have to. It would be mail order at best. I hope you also, you have to figure in the brake line diameter as well on some. I know on the Chryslers I had to, if I was going to go to a disc, that the brake line size was, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was thinner.
Well, these GMs are all 316s. That's
They are. Okay, yeah, that's good.
That is a small brake line.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't go up in size until you're like dealing with trucks.
Right. Yeah. Well, I know there was different diameters, size diameter brake lines for the Chryslers. Okay. So I wasn't sure if it was going to be, because I've never converted a GM. I've always had good luck with GM brakes. Always. Right. I've always had no problems with the shoe brakes, no problems with the discs. Right. Never had a problem. I mean, driving old Cadillacs, the brakes were always fine. It's this big lummox that I got in the garage with manual brakes. I mean, it's one step away from Flintstone stopping. I mean, for crying out loud. And mind you, I keep those the brake shoes adjusted, and they're big. We're not talking about small brake shoes here. They are huge.
Brakes are like 11 and a half. They used to be 11 and a half by two, three in the front, and either 1.5 or 2 in the rear, depending on the car.
No, it wasn't the imperial size, but it wasn't the small size either. It was, and I remember it 11 and a half.
It was probably 11 and a half by, it could be 3 in the front and 2 in the rear.
It was, it's so funny because it's an odd size in the rear. I think it's like a 2.5 because I remember having a hard time with the brake shoes because I ordered 3s and I was like, dunk. I put the brake drum on.
Yeah.
And I got half a stud. I'm like, that's not right.
Yeah.
I'm like, if I put the wheel on, it's just going to lock this thing up tight.
Right. So,
but I do remember it was something along the lines of 2.5. But yeah, the brake shoes are massive. Yet this thing's, you have to, like our old friend, God rest his soul, Mr. Steve Linden said, you got to plan your stops. And every time I drive that car and I come to an intersection, I always think of him every time.
You know, speaking of our good friend Steve, you know, I meant to tell you last week, it was last Sunday, it was 5 years ago, we lost the Goat Man. Dennis, yeah. What a shame.
That guy. Yes, the Goat Man, who is a fan of the show and a great guest. And I used to love whenever he would call, I'd go, it's the Goat Man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of cool stuff's happening.
Yes.
They're trying
to keep you awake. That's
I know. Projects are flying. There's a couple guys are looking to get into some other. If you hear anybody selling like an old rat rod kind of pickup truck, even a small cab, you know, like two, you know, like just a one bench seat, not a bigger truck. One of my buddies is looking, you know, to build something like that. So I said, yeah, they can get pretty expensive, but
they sure can. Well, there's a couple up here.
If you can get the body, you can now put that on like an S10 chassis or a smaller pickup, you know, and
that's
now
an idea.
Modern brakes and, you know, so you don't have to do brake unless you want to keep drums and really keep like an old school rat rod. Depends, you know, what you want to do.
Yeah. Well, if you use a stand, I'm thinking a regular pickup truck frame from like the 50s on a 50s type of truck. How would that be to adapt the suspension to something more modern on a frame like that?
You take the kingpins off. The aftermarket has solved all those problems years ago.
Right, because I'm thinking I would much rather have one of those 50s frames if it's in good condition compared to like a late model Silverado frame, because those things I think are kind of tiny.
Now, Silverado's too big. I mean, that's a big truck. I'm talking about like a small pickup.
Like a Ford Ranger?
Like that.
Are they? They're still body on frame, right? Yeah, I guess they would be.
Yeah, so with those... I mean, a lot of guys do like a stub chassis. They'll cut the chassis in the front, like what you need to do, like if you can do a gasser. They'll take the stock chassis and just add the front horns of a newer chassis, so they have the brakes and steering. You know, it all depends where you want to go, what you want to do. You know what your vision is for that vehicle.
Right.
Or you can stick with the stock kingpins and, you know, and nice fin drum brakes, and, you know, go do it that way. So
sure, yeah, that's a nice combination. And I like what Jay Leno does. He actually takes the disc brake affair and hides it in a drum brake cover.
The only thing I don't like about that is now you keep the heat in.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess that there may be holes or vents somehow. There would have to be, because you know, you don't want, and I know it works. So I know you don't overheat the brakes. Right. Normally.
And I'm thinking, how are you taxing those brakes? Really? I mean, unless you're going up and down major hills.
Drive. It depends how you drive. It does depend how you drive, you know, what you're doing with it.
Yeah. You know, usually with those cars, you're not pushing them to the limit.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. No, you know, no disc brake. I mean, all drum brakes are enclosed, obviously, because of the drum. But no disc brakes ever were, and part of that was to, you know,
dissipate the heat.
Dissipate the heat.
I tell you, I still love a good set of four wheel drums. I really do. I never had a problem. Even the Electra.
You and
the
Tony Electra.
Yeah, the Electra had these massive vented drums. And there was never a problem with those brakes. I always found them. They were always fine. The Caddy was the same. The problems I had with those cars were always the slave cylinders, because they were just due to age. They would leak. And yeah, I got to be really good at rebuilding those things while they were still on the car.
Oh yeah,
wouldn't even unbolt them. Just rebuild them, hone them out right there in the driveway.
Tell you what, you can rebuild now. You can rebuild your. Your show thoughts, because we're done.
We're done.
We're out of here. Kim's coming in Thunder Road. Stay tuned. I know you do, because you like her show better than Roz. What do I tell the people that are outside, not from the cricket match, just in the parking lot, waiting for me?
Right. Thank you. Don't follow us home. And thank you both for listening.
Right. All right. So, Motor Mouth Radio, Ray Guarino, Chris Switzer. We'll be back next week for more of this fun and foolery. And we'll see you there. Keep it where you got it. On 90.3 WHPC. See ya.
See ya, bud.
This show on 90.3 WHPC is brought to you by CarStar Celebrity Chase Collision, with two locations in Limerick and Oceanside, who remind you that New York State law says you always have the right to choose which shop will fix your car. CarStar Celebrity Chase Collision offers a full range of services, 24-hour towing between Montauk and Manhattan, shuttle service, and they can help you with a rental car arrangement if needed. All repairs include the CarStar Lifetime Nationwide Warranty, ensuring that the experts at Celebrity